Episode 7.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for listening to the Just Forking Around podcast. Join Debbie as she features a rotating cast of guests, which include restaurateurs, creative chefs, kick-ass servers, wicked cool winemakers, fresh farmers, and frankly, anyone who plays a pivotal part in this beautifully insane, sexy world of food and beverage. Explore with Debbie how they did what they did, why they do what they do, and discover, if you want, how you can too.
Hey everybody, how are y'all today? This next episode, I had the opportunity to sit down on my boat in Marina Del Rey with Spencer Daly, winemaker extraordinaire. He is such a great guy. We had so much fun. We had some wine. We turned on the recorder and we just chatted and talked about his trajectory and about his winemaking experience, about his family, and what it takes to be a winemaker and what it feels like to taste that wine that you've harvested the grapes and then you've crushed them by your own hands and feet. And then you put it in the barrels and then you taste it after all that work and what that feels like. So please enjoy this next episode with Spencer Daly. To participate in the Just Forking Around contest, simply answer the question that we ask at the beginning of every episode. Go to the website, justforkingaround.net, justforkingaround.net, click on contest button, submit your answer, and boom, wait to win really, really cool stuff for free on the Just Forking Around podcast. Enjoy. Good luck.
Hi, this is Sarah J. Halstead. The Just Forking Around contest question is, this widow is a legend. Her champagne is still one of the most popular labels sold today. She invented a method called riddling, which revolutionized the world of sparkling wines and champagne. Barbie Nicole Parsony is her birth name. What is the name of this widow?
All right. Welcome, everybody. I am super stoked today as I'm sitting on my sailboat in Marina Del Rey. It's a beautiful day. And I'm about to introduce my next guest. And as we are recording this episode in person, I'm sitting here with a little glass of rosé. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. And I'm excited to learn more about this guy. For he has taken his love and passion for music and has successfully been able to bridge that into winemaking. Interesting concept, but as I've been researching and reading about my next guest, Spencer is his name, I realized that his desire to become a rock star at a young age and how congruent it is that he now makes music through his winemaking. It's like poetry in a bottle. So that is something we will definitely explore with Spencer in a wee bit. And I know he has some more insight to share on that topic. So what else do we know about my next guest? Well, he grew up in Camarillo area of California. His dad planted a couple rows of grapevines in their backyard, specifically Cabernet and Sangiovese, when he was around 13 years old. And then at the age of 16, Spencer began making wine in the garage with his dad. They used trash cans for fermenters and a small Italian basket press. Unknown to both father and son at that time, what a profound influence this would have on Spencer to become a prominent figure in the world of winemaking. So now he's about 21, began working at a cellar and vineyard in downtown Santa Barbara. His passion became evident as he fell in love with the vineyard and formed his own vineyard management company. Now, once 2013 rolled around, he was in his second year of vineyard management in San Ynez Valley and realized he had the chance to harvest the fruit he had been so closely caring for. That was when, in 2013, his first harvest came to fruition. Coda Wines was born, and this was his first label, which is now Slide, which we'll talk about why this change came about in a little bit. But that first harvest was extra special to Spencer because he was able to work with the grapes from dormancy to harvest. Now, since that time, he has worked with many different influencers in the wine world. These great mentors from the Santa Barbara wine region certainly helped expedite his journey from a young kid helping his dad in the garage making wine to his current successes to date. More recently, an amazing accolade just received includes a current score of 92, yes, 92, by wine enthusiasts for his Syrah, The Show. So I am super excited to learn more about my next guest and what it takes to become a winemaker. So without further ado, a strikingly handsome, talented young winemaker who also has a deep passion for music, welcome Spencer Daly.
Thank you very much. That was a great intro.
Yeah, did yeah. I? Did
it
I?
Made me
was
sound
it accurate?
Very good. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, yeah. Welcome.
Thank you.
I'm just gonna have a little bit of your contact information here. So it's Spencer SpencerDaley.
Yeah.
And it's at and your email is codawine@gmail.com.
Yeah.
And we can also find you at codawines.com. CODAWINES.com.
That's correct. Or you can also contact me at slidewine, SLYD, @gmail.com.
Okay.
But either one definitely works.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining today.
Thank you for having me, Debbie. Yeah. I'm excited to be part of the new podcast.
Yes. Yeah. The Just Working Around podcast. So, you know, I was thinking before we get into the meat of everything or the grape of it all, what was it like at the Daly dinner table, like when you were growing up? What did it look like?
Well, so as you just mentioned, I did start, you know, very young, and all of that had to do with my dad, who is half Italian, and he was definitely a big wine drinker. And that didn't stop at the dinner table by any means. So I do remember actually the first time that I really clicked with wine and that I really, you know, had something that I enjoyed was starting at the dinner table with my dad when he snuck me a taste of his Fat Cat.
Nice.
Wine, which, as most people know and most people listening, I mean, that's, you know, a big production, you know, not considered a great wine by a lot of people. But that really struck me. You know, it wasn't complex. It was, you know, it's one of those overproduced labels, but at the same time, it was very balanced. It was very drinkable. It's kind of fruity. So that wine really struck out to me. And it was at that dinner that I really kind of fell in love with, or I kind of got the idea that I would like wine and that maybe I would kind of pursue that more as I knew my dad already was.
How old were you at, like around, I mean, of course
I don't want to get
20,
in trouble.
Okay, but when did you know?
I think I was probably like 13. Probably when I tried that.
Right,
yeah.
So because you were in the backyard, quote, vineyard.
Yeah.
With your Sangiovese and cab.
Yeah, so that was actually previous, before my dad had actually started planting a vineyard. So I think he planted it, I was probably about 14 or so. And he had a lot of interest. He had a lot of interest in starting, you know, his own home production and kind of wanted to make wine in the garage really for fun. But he ended up planting a pretty amazing vineyard. I was really excited to be, you know, help him out in it and be a part of it. And he kind of talked me into, you know, working in the vineyard with him and helping him prune and, yeah, and manage the vineyard when originally I had no real interest. So, yeah, it was starting probably when I was about 14 or so.
Wow. So it's kind of like, some people like garden tomato plants, lettuce, you know, and then especially in Camarillo, it's very agriculturally driven there, right?
It is, but not so much for vineyards.
No, definitely. Not for vineyards. Yeah.
Once again, it just originally was just kind of for fun and to try it out. And I know that was my dad's purpose originally. So Camarillo, the soil type, the weather there, you just wouldn't assume that you would be planting any like great grapes or good wine at all. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it turned out, over the years, and especially learning how to farm and take care of a vineyard, it turned out to be kind of a fun thing to develop that vineyard and produce an actual workable grape they can make drinkable wine with, was our whole goal, yeah.
So when you say vineyard, I mean, I'm picturing, like, is there a certain minimum amount of rows or of varieties or varietals or grapes that you have to have in order to call it a vineyard? Or can it just be like, what do you refer to as a vineyard?
This was it wasn't a huge, I mean, it was probably a fifth of an acre or so. There was a couple hundred vines. It was definitely bigger than any home vineyard that I had seen, especially around in the Camarillo Ventura County area. But we had our own irrigation system. We had our own drip irrigation system set up, a water pump. And then also on the property in the garage, we had, you know, a whole barn set up, basically. It was actually a separate barn that was in our backyard. And we had a drainage system set up, and we can actually produce wine there on the property. I don't know how legal it was at the time.
Yeah, but it's home.
But yeah, it was probably a couple hundred vines, and we were able to produce about 15 or 20 cases or so.
That's pretty. That's respectable.
Yeah,
that's quite respectable.
Oh, especially for being 14, 15 years old, yeah.
Right. So that was more on you. Your trajectory is a little bit on the farming side or the viticulture. Is that what you would refer to?
Yeah, originally it was all vineyard stuff. I didn't have, you know, any interest in winemaking until we really started to work in the barn once the vineyard was able to produce grapes that we could use.
How long does that take?
I mean, if you want to make an award-winning wine or a really a great wine, that would tend to take a couple, you know, 4 or 5 years, I think, is what you really are looking for. We started after about 2 years or so. We kind of jumped the gun a little bit, but once again, it was just for fun, for family and friends. So originally, it was all vineyard stuff. And once again, that kind of was stemming from me being in school and my dad just kind of giving me a job on the weekends to help him prune, help him take care of the vineyard as he kind of figured out the vineyard himself. And I thought what was really cool is when he planted it, neither of us knew anything about how the vineyard would work. So he was figuring everything out online, reading books, how to prune, how to water, irrigation, how to run the pump, spraying techniques and all that to make sure, you know, that we weren't getting too much milled rot or
there's so much that goes into it. I mean,
yeah, and especially, like you said, in Camarillo, you know, we got a lot of inland fog that would take place. I don't know if anyone knows Camarillo that well or, you know, Ventura County, but the fog would stay out until about noon or so, noon or one. And when that happens, you can kind of form a mildew, which can turn into rot on the grapes, and we would lose most of our crop. So we're figuring all that out as we started, my dad mostly. And I just didn't know much about winemaking until we were able to actually produce wine from that vineyard.
So I know Camarillo a little bit from being up in that area. We actually met in Montecito.
Yes,
we
sir,
met
yeah.
at, it was an art opening, and you were pouring.
Shout out to Alora and TJ and Laura Dining.
Yes, that was amazing. That was a great show, and that was fun. And you were pouring, and I remember, I don't think you were selling wine. You were just pouring, and that's where I met you. And I was like, please, just sell me some of this wine.
You guys were awesome.
It was like the rosé. I think it was the rosé and Sauvignon Blanc, was it?
I think it was just pouring the rosé and the Sauvignon Blanc. Yeah,
it was delish. So, yeah. So your wines are amazing. Really, really good. And when I think about winemaking, and just so much that goes into it is just, and we just open the bottle and we drink it as a consumer. And so much that goes into it. I mean, there's so much besides the bottling and the labeling but from the grapes and then the taste and what you have to add or not add. And then you have to wait and you don't know if it's going to be delicious.
Exactly. It's stressful.
So I'm going back a little bit in timeline. So now you're a kid, you're growing up, is it family? Like did you sit around dinner table eating? Like, was it food driven or was it like social driven or did you not sit down altogether? How did that work?
Yeah, I mean, so that kind of goes back to when we first actually had a wine that we made out of the garage and we could taste it. And I think that moment is when it really opened my eyes that I might have a passion for this and that I want to do it moving forward. That moment that you taste a wine after it's bottled and you know what you did. And like you just said, there's so many steps to go to get to that point. And you know when you taste it, how it got to that point and why it tastes the way it does. I mean, I think that was the creative side, and that was the creative part of me that kind of thought, well, this is kind of cool. There's so many, you know, let's try this next year. Let's do, you know, let's pick it a different time, or let's, you know, use different barrels. Let's crush differently. Let's cold soak, you know, all the cool little things you can do, even as a garage winemaker. I think that first year, and I must have been like 16, the first time that you actually had a bottle where you could pop it open, and I remember drinking it with my dad, and we discussed why it tastes this way. Maybe we should do more Cabernet instead of Sangio, but, you know, we only had the two varietals that we would blend with. So really, it wasn't so much a family thing. It was really just me and my dad sitting down, trying the wine when we're done, and once we had a wine. And I think that moment, that first time we could pop our own bottle that we made. And it was actually really funny, being a 16-year-old, you know, I got to make my own label. And that's one of my favorite things right now about the industry is the creative part of it and marketing and all that and keeping your brand updated. But doing that label, I think, was hilarious because as a 16-year-old, obviously, it was pretty wild. But it was pretty embarrassing. I called it Spencer's Bare Hands Blend. And I spelled bear, B-A-R-E, so it's like your bare hands. Okay. But on the label, it had silver chrome bear claws scratching down the label. And it was just like red and black and steel claws.
That's
you
really
know?
Cool, though. Yeah. I think that's so cool.
I still have some. And it was a hilarious label. And I remember my dad helped me design it. And so the whole thing, you know, from the label to the actual wine that we made, I mean, it was so cool to actually pop that bottle, taste the wine, see what we did, what we can change. And it was still a learning process at the moment, but it was really just me and my dad trying it together, and that was the best part, I think.
It seems like when I sort of have chills thinking about that, because it reminds me of like a very, it doesn't seem very like American in a sense of like, you know, it seems like something like European, like Italian or French, that you're sitting there and you like have this like, you grow the grapes, you know, and then you make the wine and you make the label. It seems so, it's so a small town. It's so,
it definitely was like a sexy feel, you know, it's like working in the vineyard, you know, and like, you know, doing it all in your barn, you know, it kind of has that European like stereotype, I guess you would say. Obviously, it's much different when you start working in big production and you start working for big winemakers that have an entire winery and they have the steel tanks and they have the pumps and all that, and which is amazing. But it was so fun and such so rewarding and beneficial to learn that way, to learn in the barn, to crush everything with your hands, to use a small little basket press, you know. So that I think that was the most beneficial thing for me, is that doing it all by hand, really learning the process before, you know, eventually turning 21 and then starting to work at other wineries. And
Camarillo, there wasn't, I mean, Santa Barbara makes sense of like all the areas that people grow grapes and that, you know, it's wine, wine, wine. So you must have been this kid in high school, like Camarillo, like, you know, making wine. You were probably like the dude. Were you like the guy?
Yeah. All right. So that goes back to that. I was kind of, you know, I didn't like school. I wasn't a school person. And I think it was a tough time getting to class and getting my parents, you know, to accept that. But, or I don't think they ever did. But that was one of the reasons, that goes back to why my dad had me working in the vineyard when I started, when I was 14 or 15. I think he was trying to get me to do something, you know, because I didn't want to, I just hated school, you know. And so I also,
what was it about the school? Was it like the, was it like the structure of it, or was it like the content?
I just didn't, just like irritating? I wasn't passionate about anything that we were learning about. And I think that's one of the things that I know now, you know, 10 years later. And I always think back at that, but it was really, you know, I wasn't passionate about anything we were learning about. It wasn't moving me forward. And I always knew I wanted to do something that I was passionate about, whether it was music at the time or winemaking that I started to develop a little bit. It was always, you know, I was more interested in something like that. And it was really cool having that first wine in high school and going to a party and being able to bring my own wine when nobody can buy their own alcohol.
Oh my God, that's so cool, right?
And giving it to a girl or something. Yeah. And she was like, oh, this is really cool. You made that? I was like, yeah.
And the label and the wine and the grapes. Yeah. But, I mean, that's like the trifecta.
Yeah. Doesn't matter if how shitty the wine was.
It's just cool. It's so cool.
Yeah. It was, I mean, it wasn't very good in the beginning, but it was still cool to be able to make that and amongst your high school friends, you know, like bring that out. But that had nothing to do with it at the end, but it was a cool thing, yeah.
What was the varietals, the Sangiovese and the Cab that your dad, that you grew, is that why you have such a passion for Sangiovese?
Yeah.
Is it like you have a love for Sangiovese?
Well, my dad's half Italian, and he always loved Sangiovese. So we were trying to make a super Tuscan blend with the Cab. And so
super Tuscan would be basically, it's a Sangiovese or Cab, Merlot.
I think it's mostly based off of Sangiovese, and then I think a real super Tuscan that you typically see has a little bit of Cab blended with it. And I think that's a great blend. And I did a little bit of that for this year that I'm about to release.
Nice.
I'm trying to bring that back a little bit. But so, yeah, that's why the Sangio always stuck with me, is because that was the first grape varietal that I worked with. And it really meant a lot, you know, starting from the beginning. So it always has a place in my heart.
And then and the Syrah, you just had some accolades with the wine. So Syrah, I'm just jump forward a little bit, because I know that you obviously, you like the super Tuscan, you like Cab, you like the Syrah. What was the other?
I do Sauvignon Blanc and Rosé.
Rosé.
Of Grenache.
Yeah, the Grenache.
Yeah.
That's it, the Grenache blend.
Okay. Yeah, and all that, everything besides the Sangio, because the Sangio always just stuck with me from the beginning, but everything else, it's mostly from other producers that I've tried or people that I work with, or I've grown to love Syrah, especially in the Santa Barbara County area. It's probably my favorite. One of my favorite wines that I typically look for in California that I tend to kind of just go to, I guess,
Syrah,
without really thinking about it.
I have to revisit the Syrah.
I
know. I like the GSM. I like the blend. Okay. I do like that. But Syrah straight up, I have to revisit that. I think I also tend to kind of drink by season or by food or whatever mood I'm in. And whoever I'm with. Whoever I'm with. Like, they're like, oh, you know, they lean towards Cab or Pinot. But Syrah is definitely, I feel, as I was up in Sonoma, I lived up there for a few months because I was really into the wine and I kind of wanted to like be in the earth of it all. And Syrah was definitely making a, I don't want to say comeback because it's always been around, but it seemed to be more popular or noted.
Yeah, especially And that goes back to like the Santa Barbara area, Southern California, or Central, I would say. It's such a great region for Syrah, and the growing conditions and the soil type and the vineyards that we can source from as winemakers out there. I think it's some of the, and maybe I'm biased, but I think San Ynez Valley, Santa Maria even, you know, the San Ynez, Santa Barbara County in general, I think is one of the best areas for Syrah, and you're seeing some of the best Syrah in the world out there. I think it's going to take a second for, you know, the big magazines and people to see that. That's
okay.
Not just Napa and California. Yeah.
That's okay, kind of, right?
Yeah. No, I kind of like being in an area where it's kind of the underdog, where it's Napa is what everyone thinks about outside of California, you know?
Right.
So I think it's up and coming, and certain parts of within Santa Barbara are just blowing up for certain varietals. And I think Syrah, and I work, and I give a shout out really quick to Andrew Murray, who I work for.
Oh, yeah, he's a mentor.
I think
of yours.
He's one of the, he makes some of the best Syrah I've ever had. And I think a lot of people would agree with that too. And especially in Santa Barbara County, he was one of the first ones to plant Rhone and to make Rhone wines, one of the first. And he continues to make some of the best Syrahs around. So, you know, working.
What's his label? Is it Murray? What's the
it's
label?
It's just Andrew Murray Wines.
Andrew Murray Wines?
Yeah.
What is their label similar? Is it like a silver or is it a, I mean.
It's a black label. He has the same logo for each one. He's had the same logo, I think, since like the early 90s.
Really? I mean, yeah. I don't, because I recognize, I'm like, yeah. By the label.
If you saw it, you would know.
I'll probably know.
And,
okay.
But he's been around, yeah, since 94, I think, or 93. And
I'm going to have to try some of his Syrah then. I mean, that's,
yeah.
if you're referring to.
Oh, yeah, he's, I can vouch. He's my favorite, one of my favorite winemakers around. So, yeah, he's the man.
So we now fast forward, you're 21, you're in Santa Barbara, and you're now working at a vineyard and a tasting room. And you, is it with Murray or that was like
so
a little bit later?
The day I turned 21, I started working, once I legally could, I started working at Carr Winery, which was downtown Santa Barbara.
Like and on State Street? Like
it's right off State Street, Side Street. It's called South Sepoitas.
Okay.
And now there's a Telegraph Brewery there. It's actually a really cool area. And his winery, he's got one of the coolest tasting rooms and wineries set up in Santa Barbara.
C-A-R-R?
C-A-R-R, yeah.
Yep, Carr, okay.
And his name's Ryan Carr. And that guy was awesome. He was the first one to hire me and the first person I worked for. And he gave me a huge opportunity to work in the vineyards and also work in the cellar. And kind of learn from him in the beginning. And I didn't know anything. It was such a transition to, you know, make fun wine, I guess, in the garage and sell it to family and friends and make 20 cases or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then to move into a professional winery, and especially Ryan, who was doing it for a while already, and make, you know, be around for him to make 4,000 cases, I think is what he was doing. He might be doing more. Mm-hmm. Which doesn't sound like a lot, but I mean, he's still boutique and he's a craft winery and he makes great wine.
Right, but going from 20
exactly,
to 4,000,
exactly,
that's
yeah.
Like,
and then to see the equipment, I was a deer in the headlights. I had no idea what I was doing, but Ryan had amazing patience and put me to work for whatever he could find. And
so when you're
awesome.
Working at the cellar, you're in downtown, but the vineyard is the
so he like... it was perfect because he had a cellar, he had a winery, he had the production facility and the tasting room downtown Santa Barbara off South Sepoitas. And then he also managed vineyards. I think when I was there, he managed like 17 vineyards or something.
Wow.
So a huge amount up in the valley. So it was the best of both worlds. Ryan could do it all.
Right.
And so I remember he threw me and my buddy Brett, who's actually a winemaker now, Levo Wines. Shout out really quick.
Was
Paso
it?
Robles.
Was it?
Levo.
Levo.
He's my age. He's 26, I think. And
26.
Yeah.
I thought you were 28, but no, 26.
I just turned 27.
27.
Yeah.
When was your birthday?
December 20th.
December.
Oh, damn.
So
what is it?
It's sad?
March now, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, yeah, late December, I turned 27.
Okay. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
So, yeah, it was funny because Ryan just kind of threw us out into one of his vineyards out in Santa Barbara. And we didn't really, same thing. Neither of us really knew what we were doing, but he was so patient and so cool to just kind of toss us out there. He showed us a little pruning technique. You know,
was it similar to the pruning that you had done
with
your dad?
Exactly. And I think that was so cool. Like looking back, like my dad just learned from online and reading books. And I remember I still have those books because he gave them to me. But the ones he was teaching himself with, and it was the same techniques that we were using.
That's cool.
At all the vineyards that I see now. And obviously it's universal and it's not, you know, that big of a deal, but it was still kind of cool to see that. But yeah,
I think it's kind of a big deal. I think that's kind of cool because your dad's just like kind of researching.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like yesterday, it was still a while ago, so it wasn't as accessible, all the things that you can find on the internet now.
Yeah, exactly.
So there was like, you had to buy books.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
had to look in the books.
And being as studious I am, you know, I still thought that was kind of cool. But yeah.
Yeah.
but yeah, it was fun. And Ryan gave me the first start, and it kind of went on from there. I worked at a lot of different other wineries too.
So when you started, were you thinking that your focus was going to be more on the like growing and the farming side? And then, because it seems like here in our country, at least, that it's with the winemaking that it's either you're growing it or you're making it, but growing and making at the same time
seems
not to be so common.
Yeah, I went through a lot of stages. The first stage is I actually wanted to be a vineyard manager and manage vineyards and be a part of that. And then I kind of moved on from that to doing both, which I still think is the ultimate thing. If you could manage your fruit from the beginning, from all the way from dormancy until it's time to pick, and then you take that same fruit that you were managing and produce your own wine with it, I think that's the most beneficial thing. Because any winemaker will tell you, and they'll all agree, they should agree, is that one of the biggest parts of wine and the product that you end up having in the bottle and that everyone's tasting, the biggest factor is farming. And it's how you farm, the vineyard, that the location of the vineyard, the climate, the soil, how it's farmed and all that all comes in to create that wine that you're tasting. So I always thought farming it and then producing it with the grapes that you were taking care of at the end of the day is the most beneficial thing you could do as a winemaker to really truly make that wine yours.
Yeah.
And then kind of moved on from that where, I don't have a vineyard or anything. and it's a lot of money. So maybe in the future. But that's something like Andrew Murray does. Ryan Carr does it. Yeah. Guys that I've worked with, Brian Rice from Sunstone that I worked with, he has, you know, they have a vineyard property that he takes care of also and overlooks it. So I see it, but eventually, I think that's the goal for a lot of winemakers too, is to be able to do that.
Is it to own the property or is it to say like, okay, so say so-and-so has a vineyard, say Joe has a vineyard and he wants to grow some grapes or he's been growing grapes, but he doesn't really know what he's doing. Does now like say Carr or somebody like you would come in and manage that for specifically manage that vineyard and use the techniques and tips and tools that you have and then harvest the grapes to make wine for that, for your label, or then is it?
So if you want to do it, there's a few ways you could do it. You can have your own property with the vineyard, like we already discussed, and that's like Andrew Murray does that, where he has the Curtis Vineyard, which is like 100 acres, and he produces fruit from there. But something like what you're saying is, I think Ryan was doing that, where he was like the third party basically coming in to manage the vineyard for vineyard owners. And then sometimes what you can do is part of your compensation, you can negotiate, you know, some of the fruit that you're managing. And you can, sorry, good.
Sorry, and you can, dogs all over you.
you can, part of the commission or compensation is you could take, you know, a portion of the fruit.
She's just going to jump. Come on, right. Come on.
You could take a portion of the fruit and take it for yourself, and then you can make wine from that vineyard that you farmed. So that's what I did on my first vintage in 2013. Jumping ahead really quick.
But 2013 is your first label.
That's 2013 was my first label, and already I was managing three small vineyards. One was 5 acres, one was an acre and a half, and then one was like an acre. And part of my deal was that after my second year, I wanted to take a portion of the grapes that I was using. And that's when I decided I want to make wine. If I'm farming these grapes, what if I could take a ton out of this vineyard, you know, literally 1 ton, and then
like literally a ton.
Yeah.
Like,
that's how the weight scale goes by. Like you tend to purchase by ton.
Okay. And that's the whole everything. It's not just the grapes though, is it?
That's everything. It comes with the stems. Yeah. Typically 1 ton will get you about 45 cases or so.
Okay.
45 or 50 cases, two barrels. So I figured my first vintage was I got a ton from two of the vineyards that I was farming out in San Ynez Valley. So it was Syrah and Sangiovese.
Mm. Your favorites.
My two. Exactly. And that's how it kind of started. So I was able to get 1 ton out of each one of those. And it was just part, I just took it off my bill, you know, for managing the vineyard. So that was really beneficial as my first year, as I was able to farm and then produce the wine from those grapes that I was able to farm from.
How did that feel? So
that was the best feeling.
Like, how did it feel? Like, I kind of get chills when I think about it. That just must have been like so remarkable beyond words. I mean, I don't even know. But when you think about it now, like that feeling, like what was that like?
That was, so I told you about that feeling when you first opened that bottle that we made in the garage. Yeah. I mean, think about that, but managing a 5-acre vineyard instead of a fifth of an acre and then making 100 cases instead of 15 or 20 or whatever, and doing much more work to get to that point too. So it was the coolest feeling. I released it in 2015, I think. So that was my first release. And yeah, it was the Syrah, the Sangiovese. And by that time, I had made Rosé and Sauvignon Blanc from 2014. Or no, that vintage, 2015. So yeah, it was the coolest feeling. And those two red wines, I still, obviously, I'm going to keep a case for the rest of my life. But that Sangio and that Syrah, that was a lot of fun.
And that was, I think about that. I mean, I love wine. I love the process of wine. And the more that I learn about wine and kind of dive into the wine, the more respect I have for the wine, the grapes, and everything that goes into just what, it's not just opening up a bottle. I mean, it's
exactly,
just, it's remarkable, actually, all the work that goes into it. And then watching, it's funny because I was watching, what is it? It's Burgundy, A Year in Burgundy.
Yeah.
A Year in, you know, and they were showing, I think it was A Year in Burgundy, and they were showing all the different processes of how people process the grapes, or how they handle the grapes, how they look at the grapes, how they look at the whole process. And they went from four different perspectives, and some are just like, you know, they don't prune the vines, they don't cut them back, and they talk to them, you know, that woman, she was talking to the vines. And the other one is like, it's a science of growing, this all computer, you know, and then when it's time to harvest, you harvest, and then the winemaking is kind of behind closed doors. I don't know what happens. Do you guys have like a secret code that you like don't tell anybody, like
tell anybody, but we ferment grape juice. I guess that's the thing, is the biggest part of winemaking, and that goes back to what I was saying, is farming. So we don't add a lot of craft wineries or boutique wineries. Most of the ones that, you know, you see out in the valley and basically not too buckchuck.
Right.
Most of the time we're not adding anything to our wine. Like literally what you're tasting is fermented grape juice. Yeah. So I guess that's why it's behind closed doors. It's like, we don't want to give away your secret that we're just fermenting it. I mean, obviously there's so many little things that you can do.
It's a little yeast, is it?
It's endless the amount of things you can do. The type of barrel that you use, and that's a whole nother story with itself. What forest from what part of France or what part of the world does that type of oak come from? And then how long is it toasted? Is it a new barrel? Is it used oak? Is it neutral?
The whole dance of making the barrels. What is it? The cold?
Oh, yeah. It's just all – I love the fact that they're all individual staves. I mean, if you look at a barrel, there's all these just individual ones, and it's all held together by those metal rings.
Right.
And it's all by pressure. I think that's one little cool fact. But anyways, you know, just from the barrels you're choosing from, once again, the grapes, that the vineyards that you're choosing from as a winemaker, the type of yeast that you're using, how you're crushing, how you're pressing, the temperature at which you ferment, all of that comes together to create your wine and like your style. But once again, it all starts with the vineyard and the farming technique.
Meaning like how, when you harvest, or way that the sun, where it's located, the slopes.
Like,
starting
when the vineyard was planted, like how is the vineyard planted, in what direction, like you just said, to the sun? Is it on a hillside? Is it getting a breeze? And then when you're farming, are you pulling leaves? Are you dropping fruit? Like, are you exposing the grapes a little bit more, a little bit earlier to get some sun exposure? Are you not at all? You know, all that. Are you pruning it vertically or a dual cordon or anything like that? Is it a head prune?
And then the yield, right? Like how much?
And then yield. So that's a huge thing. I think that's one of the biggest things too, is yield. And a lot of people kind of like, I don't know, they get kind of freaked out when you start literally cutting off grapes or fruit during the summertime to reduce the yield. But if you think about it, per vine, if you have a ton of production, a ton of yield per vine, all the nutrients, everything you're getting from the soil that's coming up through the vine into the grape, it's spreading out to all these different grapes when you're overproduced, you know, when it's too much yield. But when you're dropping fruit and you're into the summertime, when you have only a couple clusters per vine, then all of a sudden you're just gathering all this awesome flavor, all these cool characteristics that you can get in the grape, and it's really expressing itself a little bit more out of the vineyard. And I think that's so cool to kind of try to control that a little bit. Yeah. So when I go out in the vineyard a lot, and it's a vineyard that I'm sourcing from, I don't get to farm it anymore. So if it's a vineyard that I'm sourcing from that somebody else is farming, that's one of the things I look at before I even decide on the vineyard or throughout the harvest season, is that, I mean, is it overgrown? I think that's such a big, to me personally, I think that's a huge no-no, or it's a huge factor for me in choosing that, and if I'm sticking with that vineyard for the next year. Because if it's overgrown, it's too much growth on one vine. I mean, I feel like you're
it's like
missing
a salmon
out.
The other ones are all fighting for the
same. Yeah, they're all fighting for the same nutrients, and they're just not getting all that robust flavor and characteristics that you should be getting from that varietal. That's a huge buzz for me.
What's the difference when you look? Can just so people know. So if you're looking at a Cabernet vine, like the grape, versus like a Sangio grape, are they similar or one darker?
No. I mean, there's a lot of guys that'll tell you, like, they'll look at the grape and tell you exactly what varietal is. I can't do that, but you can generally tell on what side of the spectrum this grape is. And a lot of it comes from, like you just said, the size of the grape correlates into the body style, the color, flavor of the wine. All the flavor of wine typically comes from the skin of the grape. So if you think about it, if you have small berries, the ratio of juice to skin is much different. You have a lot more skin contact to the juice. So you're getting a little bit, the color and flavor all coming from the skins. You're getting more of that robust flavor. You're getting some more of that color. Right. So if you think about Petite Syrah is, ignore the name, but it's probably the biggest, one of the bigger wines that you can have.
Right. It's the not reason small, it's called, you mean.
Exactly. It's not a small wine. It's actually a very big wine. It's really, really dark. Like, you know, it's got bigger viscosity. But when you look at the actual grape, physically the grape is smaller, and that's where the Petite Syrah comes from, and that's why you get all that body and influence. It's all coming from that tiny berry, as opposed to like a Pinot, which is a much lighter wine. And it's a it's a much bigger berry, and Cinsault are the biggest berries Cinsault. I see. Yeah, and we just had some of this rosé.
It was delicious.
Cinsault is like, especially the ones that I see farmed out in San Ynez. I mean, there's some big ass grapes, and so they look like table grapes almost. Not to take away from any, it just correlates to the style of the wine.
So the bigger the grape,
typically is a little bit of lighter wine.
A little lighter wine. Yeah. That makes sense. That makes sense.
So because when we crush the grape, you know, we're soaking the juice and the skin all and the seeds together, the must, and that's where the color and flavor comes from. Is the juice is soaking with the skin. That's why we crush it.
Right.
When you have, you know, a ton of juice because the berry was so big, and the skin just isn't influencing as much as a little berry, which has less juice, and you're getting more ratio skin to juice contact.
That makes sense. You're not as interested in the Pinot?
No, I love Pinot.
You love Pinot?
I mean,
it's a hard grape to grow, though, isn't it?
It can be difficult. I don't know why I don't make Pinot. A lot of people make Pinot in the Valley. Some of my favorite wines are Pinot. I do have a pet peeve, though. I love all wine. And
yeah, me too.
Yeah. since I was 14. No, I'm kidding.
I was like 12.
Yeah. All right, you and me both. I don't like hate a wine or anything. They're all different styles, and I think that's a great thing about wine is that you get all these different styles. I do, though. I can't stand overripe Pinot. That's like over
like
15.
Too cherry, like what? Too
too
forward-y.
Fruity cherry. Yeah. Over. It's like
no structure. Like
no real structure. It's just fruit. Yeah, you know, and it's like over 15% alcohol, and you get a lot of that in the Valley. And I get it. It's cool, and it's super easy drinking, and it's fun.
15% is high.
Yeah, it's super high for Pinot. So what I like a Burgundian style Pinot that's more acid driven. Yeah. It can be a little spicy almost on it, and it's just a really great fit, and it's more food pairing. Yeah. But that Burgundian style Pinot is some of my favorite wine, and you can do that in San Ynez. A lot of people don't. But a lot of people do too. There's some really good ones. And it's once again,
old world, new world.
Kind of an old world, new world. So I like kind of that old world style when it comes to Pinot.
Yeah.
But on the other side of the spectrum, when it comes to like a Cabernet or a Syrah, then my California
like
bias guy
kind of
comes out. I like it, you know, I like a big Syrah, I like a big Cabernet, I like a blueberry pie Syrah, you know.
Yeah.
And I like a blackberry with a little bit of like pepper on the cab or something like that, you know.
I like the earthy.
So it's just my biggest thing is going by the varietal and not having all my wines taste the same, even though they're different varietals. I don't want my Pinot and my Cabernet to be the same alcohol percentage and to taste very similar. I think they should be very different. And I think that's what's so cool about all the different varietals.
So coming into your wine, so you have the label CODA, C-O-D-A, which is now Slide. So it was like formerly known as CODA.
It's artist formerly known as CODA Wines.
Yeah, artist formerly known as CODA, C-O-D-A Wines. So if people, is that bottle still out there? Is that label still like when moving forward, if I went, how would I be able to still buy a label that says CODA or is it kind of shifted?
So,
is there anything left? You sold out.
Yeah. So a little history behind that. Obviously my label has been CODA starting this month. And when everyone's hearing this, I'll probably have released my new label, which is Slide Wines.
S-L-Y-D.
S-L-Y-D. And The reason was because Led Zeppelin, I guess. I don't know who that is. It's some rock band. I've never heard of it.
You don't know Led Zeppelin.
But I think I was first. But they have a rock album, I guess, called Coda. Huh. No idea. I had no idea. No, I'm kidding. It is a – it wasn't Led Zeppelin. It was a – it's a,
it sounded good, though. I was really? I was there.
Yeah, Jimmy Page hit me up. Yeah. He's like,
yeah, like, hey, you got a cease and desist.
Yeah, hey, man, you're taking our name, you know. Everyone thinks of you now instead of us.
Right.
No, some Washington – some winery in Washington had the name Coda for one of their wines. I'm not going to name anything. And then, so yeah, it's a cease and desist. So I had to get rid of it. But when I first found out, I was kind of excited. I was like, how'd you guys hear about me? All right.
Right. All right.
Somebody out of
cool.
the state. Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. And you're to go back before your, the Coda wines, which I love the label and the, how you kind of came to that name and then all the different, wine bottles that you have different names. Kind of umbrelling under.
So that was kind of the whole purpose. And I know you mentioned that in the beginning of correlating music into wine.
And so congruent, right? I mean, it's just really.
Yeah, I think they're both very similar where it's an artistic form. I think wine definitely is. And I think we all know music is. It kind of shows the expression of the person behind it. So if it's music, you know, it's an expression of the person singing or playing the guitar or writing the music. And then with wine, all the wine you're tasting. As long as it's not too buck chuck, it's expressing the winemaker and it's a part of me. And it's the same thing as writing a song, pretty much, in my opinion.
And so you're romantic. You're a romantic.
Yeah.
You can't, yeah, I'm not kidding, but I'm just stating. Yeah. You're usually romantic, so I like, say, yeah, I'm romantic.
Long walks on the beach. And,
right,
sunsets.
Dinners.
Yeah, sunsets.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I think it's just, it just goes without saying, you know, the two. And so I wanted to incorporate that somehow. Obviously, you know, you want to do food pairings with wine and food is a big thing. My big thing was pairing music with wine. And I thought that was kind of a niche.
That's
that
so cool.
Kind of I can capitalize on a little bit. So I'm a huge music fan. So all my wine club members, they receive a pairing, whether it's an album or a certain song out of the album. But typically I do albums and I pair it with the with the wine. And then I'll tell you a little bit why I chose that pairing and
awesome.
What it meant to me. And then also, as you just mentioned, each wine is named after a piece of music. So that was all the way in the beginning in 2013 on my first release. My Sauvignon Blanc was called Overture Sauvignon Blanc. Mm-hmm. My rosé is called the Medley Rosé. It was a blend of different varietals, so it was a medley. Sonata Sangiovese was 100% Sangio, so Sonata is like a solo piece.
Yep.
And then the Cadence Syrah, it's kind of the ending of your tasting if you went through
Cadence.
My flight.
Yeah,
so the Cadence Syrah was kind of that. And I still kind of stick to the names, but my biggest thing about marketing and keeping the brand alive is I like to do stuff different each year and be creative that way. And I think creativity is so important in the industry.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think my Sauvignon Blanc is still going to be called Overture. My Rosé is still Medley for sure. Yeah. But the Sangios change, the Syrah. So I change it every year.
So is the new label, the Slyd, S-L-Y-D, is it still going to be your kind of creative influence of the labels? Because I know that you seem to be like, you seem to get joy out of doing the labels. You seem to, that's another part of the whole operations that you have. I mean, it seems like.
That's one of my favorite parts. And that, I think winemaking in general is a creative process. I'm all about brand recognition and, you know, keeping people interested. And my biggest thing, you know, with wine, there's so many wineries out there and there's so many up and coming winemakers and so many brands out there and they all make them. There's so many great wines and these guys are all making such great wines. So it's, to me, it's kind of trying to stick out a little bit. And I think one of those ways of doing it is keeping the interest alive and keep people waiting and doing different labels that are creative. I do like to keep my name on all the labels. So there is some recognition, but at the same time, I think the labels are part of the art form too.
Yeah, it is.
And it's part of the creative process that is winemaking in general. So
when I think of, I loved what the Coda and the wine, the labels that you had in the kind of how the narrative of how it all kind of connected back to the music and the Coda and then the winemaking. When I think of like some other cool wine labels, I still think of like, what's his name? You know, Prisoner
Orin
and Machete.
Swift.
Orin Swift. What's his name?
Orin Swift.
Yeah, but his name is Rich. I forget his name.
What do you mean?
Mark, his actual name. Because
I don't know his actual name.
I forget. Sweeney? Sweeney?
Oh, that sounds familiar, yeah.
Sweeney, I think. Anyways, but his labels were...
Yeah.
It's. I know that that's something different, but when I saw your labels and how you're... And I know it probably wasn't influenced similarly, but when I saw your labels and how you were expressing through the music and through Coda and then the different kind of names, it reminded me of how his label had his, like... It's so crazy, almost like all the different... styles of the pictures. It reminded me of Andy Warhol. His did a little bit, you know, kind of thing. But I think that that helped him become, you know, whoever he and sold off Prisoner or whatever.
Yeah.
But I didn't mean to compare your wine to that.
No.
But it was just interesting with the labels, because labels, remember when I asked you about, was it Murray? About what
Andrew
his
label, yeah.
What his label looks like, because I do appreciate wine. I love wine, but I also have this, like, when I'm looking for something, it's easier for me to just like, find the label in a store or online or something.
So that's a perfect point. And I mean, Orrin Swift, I also think of Herman Story, Russell Story, his wines. I don't know if you've heard of this,
but
he's up in Paso, and it's kind of similar where they're like photographs or they're pictures or paintings, whatever it could be. And they don't actually have their name on it. They'll have it on the back label. And I think that's really cool. So I love that, and those are like idols to me for branding.
Right.
And
Bonnie
all that,
Doon,
and the marketing.
That Graham, what's his name? Graham from Randall Graham. Bonnie Doon is in Santa Cruz.
Yeah,
I don't know if you know, like Cardinal Zinn. I know he has some crazy labels.
Okay, yeah, I know that one. All those labels are out of control,
and that's what pops out. Yeah,
yeah, they're pop out. I do want to keep my name on it is one of my biggest things, but I like that aspect of having. You know, whether it's photos or art, and I've incorporated artists into my labels too, and it's what I've tried to do in the past. So I had a Sauvignon Blanc I released in 2015 that I had a picture of a saxophone player. It was a painting, and that was done by a local artist in LA, Kelsey Foremost.
Nice.
And then I'm doing a photography series with a guy named Anthony Horvath in Santa Barbara, who's a genius in my opinion, and he does. We did the show that got the 92.
Yeah.
That was his label that he helped me design, and we did a guy smashing a guitar.
Next
one, we're going to do a drummer.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, so you're like...
I want to incorporate artists that I know, especially that I know. I like...
Yeah.
You know, I like using my friends, not using, but
yeah.
I like using my friends.
I like
friends,
using
yeah,
my friends.
Yeah.
Hey, you go.
I like incorporating my friends to be involved with it and people that I trust. And, you know, at the same time, it's fun to do that together. So,
It's also building a cool community, too.
Yeah, it's like building a community. And whether it's, you know, the layout of one of the labels, I use my friend Alma from high school or from college. And, you know, he's in marketing and all that. So he's still going to class, and I have him doing all my layouts. And then,
That's cool.
Anthony Horvath, Kelsey Foremost, you know, some of these artists that kind of have their perspective on the label, too. And I think that's really cool to surround yourself that way with people who are just as creative or more creative than you, too.
Right.
So it's
building the team.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
When I think about your, now we're going to transition to slide. So it's still obviously it's in barrels still right now because you have to constantly stay, a year and a half ahead of yourself?
Yeah.
You have to stay 18,
I'll release,
18 months ahead.
The slide wines this April.
Okay. And that it will be under slide.
This month,
when you were making the wines and when you were barreling them, you were thinking it was still Coda in your mind.
Yeah.
So that's interesting, right?
Yeah.
So it's like, so Coda's, it doesn't, I guess, matter the mantra, the name, but the spirit of it.
Yeah. No, I'm going to keep making the wine that the way I do and the labels and keep doing all that, whether it's Coda or Slide. And if anything, it was a lot of fun getting to rebrand and change the name and
be creative. Kind of like
I just love doing that. And that's one of my favorite parts. So I'm upset, obviously, that I had to change the name Coda. I love Coda. But I think Slide's going to be, it's the same wines, it's the same winemaker.
I like the name Slide.
Yeah.
S-L-Y-D, it's good. It's catchy. So what's it like to be where you're at now? So you're 26.
Yeah.
26. You've been making wine now since you were 13, which is, been around the wine for 13. So what happens now? Like, what's the next, like, is it to become... Like, what's the trajectory? I don't like to say what's your 10-year plan or 5-year plan, because I think that's like just doesn't really happen.
Yeah.
But what does one do where they're at, where you're at now? Like, what's the next?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think a lot of people probably consider that. I would like to have a tasting room and my own production facility relatively soon. I was actually looking at a tasting room this year.
Like in Los Olivos? Or
actually, in L.A.
L.A.? Cool.
Yeah, I want
nice.
To. I think there's I like a lot it. Of, obviously, a huge population in L.A. You don't get that many small production wineries in L.A. at all.
I think it'd be great if you did that.
So I think it'd be really cool. But the goal is to have my own production facility also and be making the wine. And then also to continue to make quality as opposed to quantity. Yeah. I'm not interested in making a ton of wine. Right. I'm interested in continue to be creative and make the best wine that I can and not try to get on every shelf in every market and kind of keep it more wine club members and kind of keep it tough to get, but at the same time make the best wine that I can. And
is that the way to distribute now is like DTC, right? Is that the direct to consumer in a sense, or is it do you go in restaurants or is it like,
to help get my name out in the first 2 years, 3 years now, I've been selling it through markets and restaurants and selling in wholesale and also developing a wine club membership, selling online and doing all that. But there's a benefit to selling it through the markets and restaurants and to sell it wholesale because you are getting your name out there and you're trying to get some recognition. So I'm fine with doing that, and I'll still continue to do it to restaurants I really respect and admire and that have great wine lists and places that people really do go to actually, taste the wine and try to find new wines that they like.
Yeah.
But my goal right now is to continue to develop. My main goal is to continue to develop a wine club membership and be able to go direct to consumer, mail them wines that they really do want, right, that they're signing up for, and keep them kind of interactive in the whole process too.
So I didn't sign up for your wine club, and I'm going
really
to.
Upset.
No, I'm
yeah.
going to. I'm no, totally okay. going to. I'm definitely going to. And I haven't. It's funny because I haven't. I'm not. Do people when they join wine clubs, do they do multiple wine clubs normally, or is it like a one shot? Like, how does that work with your?
I think a majority of club members are members of other clubs too, which that's great. You want that. I mean, that's great. So, I think from what I've seen working in tasting rooms at various wineries, when they're signing up for a club, they'll say, oh, I got to drop one, which I'm like, that's the greatest problem to have. Like, they have too many wine club memberships,
right?
Which that still amazes me. Like, I want to get to that point at
some
point.
Yeah. I mean, so people are going to say I'm listening to this podcast and I'm like, okay, I want to try this wine. Yeah. It's not a slide. So now what would be the best way?
You can go online to slidewines.com.
S-L-Y-D.
S-L-Y-D-wines.com. And there'll be a way for you to join the membership. And there's three different memberships. It's the fan club, it's the roadie club, and the groupie club.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah, I'm not changing that either.
Yeah, so, definitely don't change that.
So the fan club, is you get four bottles, I think. And then the group roadie is six bottles and the groupie is eight bottles. And it's usually three times a year or so.
Nice.
So I think that was kind of a fun thing to do. And
can you ship anywhere? Isn't U.S. laws have like this some crazy shipping
not
stuff?
Not to
isn't it? Like,
Massachusetts.
Yeah, Massachusetts.
And Utah,
can,
of course.
Yeah.
And Pennsylvania.
I think
there's
some
a few
strange,
spots.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate.
Yeah, it is. Because I'm from Massachusetts. I'm from Boston.
Are you a Celtic fan?
I am. I'm a Celtics.
Ooh, we gotta end this.
I know. I know. I'm sorry. I mean, from Boston. Yeah, I mean, I grew up there, so I have to. I stick to the Bruins and the Celtics and the Patriots, the Red Sox. Red
this is
Sox.
Brutal.
I know. It's
I'm a Laker fan.
You are.
Dodgers.
Yeah. I mean, so I almost had a New York hat on today, and I was thinking,
I'm glad
I would
you
take.
Did it, yeah.
Yeah, that was like, that's I got to keep it neutral, so I have like a Packer hat.
Yeah. No, that's awesome.
So I think I was going to ask you one other question about, just to bring it back to where when we started, and I was saying how congruent music is to wine. And that I don't think I'm the first person that's like poetry in a bottle. And I think that one of the most amazing opportunities that people have, I mean, literally there's this quote, it's like the best way to express the inexpressible after silence, the best way to express the inexpressible is through music. And then I think you should add on to it. And wine.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, you can, you can speak any language and not be able to hold a conversation with another person. But if you sit and listen to music, I mean, you can both agree on something, or you can both enjoy the same song, mm-hmm. Same thing with wine. You can sit down and enjoy a wine that maybe you guys can't communicate that well, or it'll bring people together. So both of them do. Especially when you combine the two and you drink a few bottles and you play some good music.
Yeah,
and
I mean,
it's
game
over.
Like,
But yeah, it's just the creative aspect to it. And that's what really got me like involved with both of them and trying to involve both together.
Yeah.
Is the biggest thing. Yeah.
So I'm excited. Thank you so much for spending the time today.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you.
And I'm excited for your next, I'm going to check in with you. We'll have you back on the show probably a little bit later within, I don't know, 6-8 months. And I'm excited to see the update with the slide.
Yeah, definitely.
And the labels and we can,
I'll be around pouring at local events. I'll be posting through my newsletter, which you can also join online at slidewines.com to keep everybody updated. But in April, I'm going to do the Garagies Festival in San Inez.
The San Inez.
And then I think I'm doing the Long Beach Grand Cru event, which is usually June. And then the Taste of Camarillo in July. So yeah, there's a few events. And
okay, I'll put them all in the show notes.
Out there, yeah.
Yeah, I'll put them all in the show notes.
Okay,
so
cool.
That with the links and everything. So that that was quick on that. So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Debbie.
Awesome. And I look forward to tasting more of your wines.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Hey, everybody, I hope you enjoyed listening to that episode. And again, please rate and review if you did like this podcast episode or any of the other ones. Please go to iTunes, download, rate, review. I appreciate that very much. Just Forking Around Podcast. And again, I am Debbie Salzberg. My handle on Instagram is @ForkingPodcast. My website is justforkingaround.net. And I am so excited to have you on board here with me on the Just Forking Around podcast. And I look forward to seeing you on the next show. Thank you.